So the last speaker of the session is Shem Borst, and is from TU Eindhoven, and he will speak about scalable load balancing in networked systems.
Thank you for the introduction. It's really a great honor and pleasure to give a talk here today. And I would like to present some joint work with some of my colleagues, whom you see listed here, Mark van der Boer, Johan van Leeuwarden, De Banker Mukherjee, and Phil Whiting on scalable load balancing. So load balancing is a crucial issue in parallel server systems. And here you see a schematic representation of what such a system looks like. So there are a bunch of parallel servers, let's say N, and a single dispatcher where tasks or service requests arrive that need to be executed by one of the servers. But quite often it's difficult to maintain a centralized queue at the dispatcher, and therefore the moment the tasks arrive, they need to be immediately assigned to one of the servers. So we need a decision policy for how to assign tasks to servers over time. And these scenarios are commonly encountered in daily life. If you think of a supermarket, it is quite rare to see a single line for checkout. Typically, you would see multiple lanes at a various checkout counters. In fact, I personally know only one counterexample to that. And in fact, the model that I just showed is often referred to as the supermarket model because it has a certain similarity with the situation that is encountered there. A further example is a road toll plaza, where again it would be impractical for the vehicles to line up in a single queue to go through the toll booths. So instead, there would be sort of multiple lanes associated with each of the toll booths. And then the application that has really sparked a very strong interest in load balancing problems in the last few years are data centers. So these are sort of the factories of today's digital world, operated by companies like Google, Facebook, Amazon. So these are huge buildings packed with thousands and thousands of servers. And it's really that huge scale of operation that raises scalability challenges. And you can maybe already imagine if you have a supermarket with 10 maybe checkout lanes or 20, it gets very difficult to decide which checkout counter you want to join. So now imagine a data center with tens of thousands of servers, how complicated it gets to assign tasks to the servers in an efficient way. So here's roughly the outline of the talk. I'll say a few more words on these scalability issues and review some classical results in that regard. Then I'll turn to asymptotic optimality of what are called randomized load balancing strategies. Next, I will discuss how the overhead in making the assignment decisions can be reduced by leveraging memory at a dispatcher. And then finally, I'll touch on some heterogeneity issues and some network scenarios. Okay. So here's a somewhat more detailed description of the model that I showed. So again, we have the N parallel servers here at the bottom, each with an exponential service rate mu. And here we have the single dispatcher where tasks arrive as a Poisson process of some rates N lambda. So N is the number of servers, so you can think of lambda as the effective arrival rate per server. Now, a very simple strategy to assign the tasks to the various servers would be to just use random coin flipping and assign each task with equal probability, 1 over n, to any of the servers. So in that case, the arrival process at each of the servers will be Poisson with rate lambda, and that means that each of the servers essentially behaves as an MM1 queue in queuing terminology, where the first M stands for the Poisson arrival process, the second M indicates that the service times are exponentially distributed, and the one denotes that there's a single server at each of these queues. And in fact, because of the properties of the Poisson process, these N queues would also evolve independently over time. So that provides us with a simple reference point. If we adopt a very simple random routing policy, then the system will behave as a collection of N independent MM1 queues, and that means that the total queue length across all the servers in expectation will scale linearly in N, and the waiting time in expectation for each of the tasks will not depend on N at all. It's just the mean waiting time in an MM1 queue. So it's not clear at this point whether that's good or bad, that it doesn't depend on N, but we'll see in just a moment. And for that, I'll look at the other extreme. So now imagine that we could somehow pool all the N servers as a single resource and operate a centralized queue. And as I mentioned, that is quite often difficult for various reasons. We will just use it as sort of an ideal performance benchmark that would be difficult to actually achieve in a distributed setting, because it's inevitable that sometimes we will have some servers sitting idle while tasks are waiting to be served at other servers, because we have to make these decisions right when the tasks arrive. But let's think of it as an ideal performance benchmark. And again, that corresponds to a classical queuing system, an MMN queue, because now all the N servers are pooled together. And it follows from the results for that model that the overall queue length in that case is smaller than it is here on the left by a factor at least of order N. And that also translates into a mean waiting time that is smaller by a factor at least of order N, implying that the waiting time will decay as 1 over N as the system size in terms of N grows large. Now, again, recall that N is the number of servers, which could be huge, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands. So there's a huge improvement to be obtained if you could somehow approach that performance provided by a pooled system. And that raises the question, can we think of smart task assignment strategies that would achieve that? Now, a very natural and classical strategy that comes to mind is join the shortest queue, which sort of does what the name suggests. It always assigns tasks to the shortest queue. So here's a task that arrives. The dispatcher figures out what the shortest queue is. In fact, there are two in this case, and it just assigns the tasks to one of them at random. Then the next task arrives. At that point, it's the first queue that is the uniquely shortest one, and that's where the task goes. Okay? Now, it turns out that this policy is not just very natural. It also has some optimality properties, which might seem obvious, but they are not so trivial, actually, to prove. And to state them, I will need some sort of state description, where the natural state description would be just to keep track of the queue length at each of the servers and say that xk is the queue length at server k. But it's often more convenient to rearrange the queues in increasing order from left to right, say, and say that x sub k is the size of the kth shortest queue, so it's sort of the kth vertical stack in this picture. And because of the symmetry among the servers and the Markovian assumptions, this is an equivalent state description where we just lose the identity of the servers, but in terms of the overall evolution of the system, it is a proper Markovian state description. When we keep this picture in mind, there's actually yet a further state description that is equivalent and that will be very useful for our purposes, which is to look at the horizontal bars and denote the width of the ith horizontal bar by qi. So that's essentially the number of servers that have a queue length of I or larger. And then we can also look at the what are called fluid scaled versions of that, where we normalize qi of t by n, the total number of servers, so that would give us the empirical fraction of servers with a q length I or larger. And now we have sort of created a state description that lives in a state space that doesn't depend on n anymore, and that will be very convenient for the purpose of establishing scaling limits. Okay, so here are the stochastic optimality properties of the during the shortest queue policy. If we look at the partial sums of the largest queues, then these are stochastically smaller under the during the shortest queue policy than under any alternative non-anticipating policy, meaning the policies that have no advanced knowledge of the surface times of the tasks. There's a very similar property that can be stated in terms of the QI variables, that if we look at the top horizontal bars, their sum is, again, stochastically smaller under the join the shortest queue policy than under any alternative non-anticipating policy. And then if you take a very special case of that by just looking at the sum of all the vertical stacks or all the horizontal bars, we get the total number of tasks in the system, and that is then stochastically minimized by the join the shortest queue policy among all non-anticipating policies. And that in particular implies that the mean waiting time is minimized under the join the shortest queue policy. Okay, so that's stochastic optimality. It doesn't directly tell us how much better join the shortest queue is compared to alternative policies. So it turns out that it can bring huge performance improvements in the regime where n, the number of servers, grows large, for example, compared to the random assignment policy that I first described. In particular, it sort of eliminates queues. So here, let's say that PIN is the probability that the queue length at a particular server is I or larger in the nth system with n servers. Then for the random routing policy, if we assume for the convenience that mu is 1, the service weight is 1, the queue length distribution is geometric with parameter lambda. We can now think of the arrival rate lambda as the load. Whereas for join the shortest queue, if you look at these probabilities, the probability of seeing two or more tasks at a particular server vanishes in the limit. So we will not see any queues at any of the servers with very high probability as the system overall grows large in size, and we'll just see a fraction lambda of the servers that have exactly one task in their queue. The remaining fraction, 1 minus lambda, will have an empty queue. Okay? And that translates into huge improvements in terms of the mean waiting time as well. It will sort of go to zero in the limit. If we look at a critical load regime where the lambda approaches 1 with some slack of the order 1 over square root of n, we can even be more specific that we see an improvement of the order n, very much like I showed before in the pooled scenario relative to the case of completely random task assignment. Okay, so the waiting times are essentially eliminated as well, but there's a but. And the but is that the join the shortest queue policy involves a very high communication overhead. In order to implement the policy as I described it, what a dispatcher needs to do is it needs to send queries to all the end servers when a task arrives to check their queue status. All the end servers have to send responses back, so again, n messages. So in total, 2 n messages need to be exchanged between the dispatcher and the servers in order to assign just a single task. So this is not the total overhead, it's the overhead per task that grows with n, and this is not scalable when n grows large. Okay? So before I discuss further that sort of communication overhead and what can be done to reduce that, let me say just a few words on where these results come from, because they're actually surprisingly recent. So this is in a regime where the total arrival rate, lambda n, is almost equal to n, the total capacity of the system, with a gap of order square root of n, meaning that the relative capacity slack is of order 1 over square root of n. So as we scale n, the system both grows large in size, but it also enters a critical load regime. So in that case, the natural scaling to consider is for these variables qi and t to consider them on a scale square root of n, it turns out, where additionally, for the first one, the q1, which keeps track of the number of busy servers, we also center around n, because the overwhelming majority of servers will have at least one task in their queue. So if we do that, it turns out that that sequence of processes has a weak limit as n grows large, which is shown here and is described in terms of a system of stochastic integral equations. Okay. So this sort of shows that over finite time intervals, the scaling of the q's is of order square root of n. And an even more recent result by Braverman showed that there's actually an interchange of limits between large n and large t. So even in the stationary regime, the scaling of the q variables is of order square root of n. And that is really at the basis of the waiting time results that I just showed in the table. So let me now come back to the high communication overhead associated with join the shortest queue and what can be done to address that. So a very popular class of strategies that have been proposed are sometimes called randomized load balancing policies or join the shortest queue D policies, which fall somewhere in between the purely random routing policy that I described and the full join the shortest queue policy. So here, what the dispatcher does is, rather than check the queue status of all the servers, it just selects a few D servers, let's say uniformly at random, asks about their queue length, and then sends the task that arrives to the shortest queue among those servers. So that's illustrated here. A task arrives. The dispatcher randomly samples two servers, 2 and 6 in this case. And server 2 has the shorter queue, so that's where the queue, where the task goes. And note that this is not the shortest overall queue. Next task arrives, so now the dispatcher again samples two queues at random. Clearly, the first queue is now the smallest one, so that is where the task is assigned. Okay. So this class of policies has been analyzed in the mid-90s. Through a fluid limit analysis, where we look at these fluid scaled state variables, the qi and t, and it turns out that the sequence of stochastic processes converges again to a weak limit, but now the weak limit is completely deterministic and characterized in terms of a system of differential equations that you see here, where the first term with the lambda reflects the dynamics due to the arrivals of tasks, and that term in square brackets that you see there represents the probability that an arriving task is assigned to a server with queue length I minus 1 given a fluid level state Q of t. And then the second term with the mu reflects the dynamics in this process due to service completions and departures of tasks from the system. Turns out that this system of differential equations has an explicit fixed point, which is shown here. And again, it turns out that the limits, large t, large n, can be interchanged. So here we had first taken the limit for large n, and then we let t go to infinity. In the PIN, we had first looked at a stationary regime with t going to infinity, but we can also now let n grow large there. And then the two limits will interchange, meaning that the qi star also represents the Q-length distribution, stationary Q-length distribution, as the size of the system grows large. So what we see is that the tail of the Q-length distribution falls off super exponentially compared to the geometric decay that we observed in the case of purely random routing. So a much faster decay in the tail of your Q-length distribution, even when D is small as d equal to 2 or 3. And that is often referred to as the power of two effect, that by just sampling a handful of servers, two or three, we get a huge improvement in the queue length behavior compared to a purely random assignment. And at the same time, we reduce the communication overhead significantly compared to the full join the shortest queue policy. So that is shown here in the table. So now we have sort of an additional row for the join the shortest QD policy with a much sort of steeper decay of the queue length distribution, which also translates into improvements in the mean waiting time performance with a small amount of overhead, a constant overhead 2D per task. But again, there's a but that even though the waiting time is a lot smaller than it is under the strictly random routing, it does not vanish just for the join the shortest queue policy. And in fact, when we are in the critical load regime, it will grow with N. So even though the join the shortest queue D policies bring a huge improvement compared to strictly random routing, they do not achieve the optimality, not even asymptotically, of the full join the shortest queue policy. So that same observation is illustrated here from a somewhat different perspective. Again, for random routing, we get a geometric tail of the queue length. If we go to taking two or three samples, we get a super exponential decay in the queue length distribution. But we don't see the complete elimination of queues that is achieved by full join the shortest queue. So that raises the question, what happens in between? Like, how large should D be as function of N in order to achieve the asymptotic optimality provided by the join the shortest queue policy? And in order to examine that, we allow D to be a function of N, and we write Dn to reflect that. And what I'll show in just a moment is that as long as Dn grows large, even at an arbitrarily slow rate, the join the shortest queue Dn policy will have the same fluid limit behavior and therefore achieve optimality on fluid scale as the join the shortest queue policy. And if Dn grows fast enough, namely faster than square root of n log n, the join the shortest queue Dn policy will have the same diffusion limit as the join the shortest queue policy and thus also yield diffusion level optimality. Okay, so for that we look at the fluid scaled state variables as before with now the dn, because they now depend on the number of samples that we take. And what we showed was that the limit of those sequences is given by these differential equations no matter exactly what the behavior of dn is, as long as it grows large with n. So this is sort of a universality result that for a whole class of join the shortest queue Dn policies, we observe the exact same fluid limit, which in turn is identical to the one for join the shortest queue. And here, the PI Q of T that you see, it is the probability that an arriving task gets assigned to a server with a queue length I minus one. And there's an explicit expression for that, but it's a little involved, so that's why I didn't show it on the slide. So it means that the join the shortest queue Dn policies, they have the same fluid limit behavior, so they produce fluid level optimality, but at the same time, they do it with an overhead that can be nearly a factor of order n lower than it is for join the shortest queue. So that's a huge improvement. And here you see what the fixed point is of that fluid limit, also for future reference. We see that the Q1 star is lambda. So we have a fraction lambda of the servers that have exactly one task in their queue, which is being processed. The fraction of servers with two or more tasks vanishes in the limit. And then the remaining fraction, one minus lambda of the servers, have an empty queue. We can also look at the diffusion limit, which provides a somewhat more refined view of the situation than the fluid limit, which is somewhat crude perhaps. And there we look at the same sort of scaling regime, where the load approaches 1 with a relative slack capacity of the order 1 over square root of n as the number of servers grows large. And we look at the same sort of diffusion scaled state variables as before. And then we get the somewhat similar universality result, but now the dn must grow at least as square root of n log n. And for all these sort of growth rates, we will see the same diffusion limit as was established by Gamarnik and Eschenfeld for the case of full joined shortest queue. Okay? So the same kind of observations, we see the same diffusion level behavior, in particular diffusion level optimality, within a communication overhead that can be reduced by nearly a factor of square root of n over log n compared to the full joined shortest queue policy. And that condition is in fact nearly sharp, that if the rate of growth of dn is strictly less than that, then the diffusion limit is provably different from what it is for joined shortest queue. So that's again summarized here. As long as dn grows large, we achieve fluid level optimality with a much lower overhead. If dn grows faster than square root of n log n, we achieve diffusion level optimality, again, with an overhead that is significantly reduced compared to full joined shortest queue. And that gives us two additional rows in this table where we see sort of the same green scores in terms of waiting time performance as we see for joined shortest queue, asymptotically. And the overhead, it does grow now with n, so it's not entirely green anymore, but it grows much slower than it does for the full joined shortest queue policy, and hence the somewhat yellow, pinkish colors that you see in the overhead column. Okay, so that sort of raises the question, can we somehow reduce the overhead further and still observe a vanishing waiting time in the limit? And there's the result that I think I already showed but didn't really mention by Gamarnik, Tsitsikles, and Subaldia, saying that in order to achieve a vanishing waiting time, if you don't have any memory at a dispatcher to keep track of your state information, the communication overhead must grow with n. So the only way to achieve a vanishing delay with a constant communication overhead is to introduce some memory at a dispatcher. And that could be done in the context of these randomized load balancing policies by using the observations that you obtain when you want to assign a single task rather than throw it all away and somehow store that information and use it for assigning future tasks. So that could be done. I don't have time to really discuss these schemes here today. I will look at a somewhat different class of schemes which also use memory at the dispatcher, but they are more server-driven than dispatcher-driven. In particular, I will look at the joined idle queue strategy, which again sort of does what the name says. So here what the servers do is when they empty their queue, they will send a token to the dispatcher to inform the dispatcher that the server is ready to take on the next task. So here, second server becomes idle, it also sends a message to the dispatcher. What a dispatcher then does is when a task arrives, it just takes one of the tokens that it has and it sends the task to the corresponding server and it throws away the token. Next task arrives, this is a very lucky task, there's exactly one token left. So this task is assigned to the last remaining idle server to start execution immediately, and then maybe a next task arrives. Lagging behind a little bit. This task is sort of out of luck because the dispatcher has run out of tokens, and rather than trying to do anything smart based on previous observations, it just assigns that task to a randomly selected server, just like under random routing. So this scheme has a very low communication overhead because the servers will only send a message to the dispatcher after a service completion, if that service completion leaves their queue entirely empty. So the message overhead is at most 1 per task, so very low by design. And somewhat surprisingly, Stolyar showed a few years ago that the fluid limit has the same fixed point for the joint idle queue policy as it has for the full joint shortest queue policy. So apparently, just knowing where the idle queues are is enough asymptotically to achieve optimal performance. Using any more detailed queue length information doesn't really improve the performance at fluid level. Now, again, this is achieved with very low communication overhead, and that is sort of really remarkable. But one can argue that the fluid limit is somewhat crude, so we also looked at that in the diffusion regime, and it turns out that, again, joined idle queue has the same diffusion limit as full joined shortest queue under the sort of critical load regime. So that really shows the strength of the joined idle queue strategy, that it outperforms these joined shortest queue D policies in achieving vanishing waiting time and having a constant communication overhead at the same time. Whereas under the randomized load balancing policies, you can have a constant overhead, but then your waiting time will not vanish, or you can achieve a zero delay in the limit, but then your communication overhead needs to grow with the size of the system. So that is really a very powerful property of the joined idle queue policy. Okay. So this sort of adds the final column in this, sorry, the final row in the table that you see here, joined idle queue. So it sort of scores green in all respects in terms of waiting time performance as well as overhead by taking advantage of the memory at the dispatcher. And that is probably not a really big deal from a practical perspective, because all you need is really to keep track of n bits to maintain the idle busy status of the various servers. Okay, let me finally touch on heterogeneity issues and network scenarios. So a very sort of critical assumption in the supermarket model that I considered so far is that all the servers are symmetric, so that any task can be handled by any server. And in practice, you would often see that certain tasks can be handled faster or better by some servers than others. So that may have to do with the fact that the execution of the task, if you think of a data center, involves some data records that are only stored at some of the servers and are not replicated across the entire server population. So that means that the servers that have direct access to these data files, or have sort of at least convenient access to these data files, will be better positioned to execute these tasks. And there could be all sorts of other reasons why there might be some affinity relations between some servers and particular task types or other compatibility constraints. So there's really a whole variety of models that can be considered to capture these heterogeneity issues. We considered one particular class where we assume that the servers are interconnected by some underlying graph topology, as is shown here. So this, for example, could capture the data locality that I mentioned. So the assumption now is that when the task arrives at one of the servers, so we no longer assume a single dispatcher, that task can either be served by that local server, or it can be forwarded to one of the neighbors of that server in this graph if one of these neighbors has a shorter queue. So it's essentially the join the shortest queue policy, but now operating on top of this graph topology. And as I mentioned, this topology could capture the data locality or other compatibility constraints between tasks and servers in your system. So here it's sort of illustrated. Task arrives, the server checks with its neighbors, and surely there are two that have shorter queues, and that's where the task goes. So that raises the question, how does that graph structure affect the performance in terms of queue lengths and waiting times? And it turns out that is a challenging question, because the network structure destroys the inherent symmetry among the servers. So if we just keep track of the ordered queue lengths or the QI variables, that no longer provides a Markovian description, because we would also need to keep track of the identity of the servers. And that makes a direct analysis of fluid limits or diffusion limits very challenging for an arbitrary graph structure. What we can do, however, is making a stochastic comparison between a graph, an arbitrary graph, and a different graph. For example, the complete graph. And that's essentially what we do, and see what we can then say about sort of the performance in these two cases. So here you see an example of the complete graph, where a task arrives, so the server checks with all its neighbors, which are now all the servers in the network, and it assigns the task to the one with the shortest queue. So that is no different than ordinary supermarket model with full join the shortest queue. So a fully connected graph is exactly sort of the standard setup with full join the shortest queue. And that is the perspective that we take, and we make a comparison between an arbitrary graph structure and a fully connected graph. If we can somehow show that the two are close, that would again provide us a notion of asymptotic optimality and universality. Okay, so that then sort of raises the question, so what sort of graph structure would we need in terms of connectivity to observe the same performance asymptotically as we would see in the case of a complete graph? Or slightly different way of phrasing that question is, how much sparsity can we allow in the graph topology and still retain the asymptotic optimality of a fully connected topology? A slightly different related question would be to ask that question for the join the shortest queue D policy. What are the conditions on the graph in order for join the shortest queue D to produce the same behavior in a given graph as in a fully connected graph? But again, I don't have time to address that question here today, so we'll just focus on the case of full join the shortest queue, but restricted to a graph topology. And it turns out that the relevant graph conditions, informally speaking, are stated in terms of neighborhood sets. So we will look at sets of order n nodes, and condition one says that the neighborhoods, collective neighborhoods of these subsets of nodes should cover essentially the entire graph except for a little order of n nodes. The second condition is even a little stronger, that even if we look at subsets of just order squared of n nodes, that should cover the entire graph up to only little order of square root of n nodes. And then we'll say that a graph sequence, Gn, is either fluid optimal or diffusion optimal if we see the same behavior on fluid scale or diffusion scale as we would observe in a fully connected graph. And it turns out that condition one is sufficient for fluid level optimality, whereas condition two is sufficient for diffusion level optimality. So these are pretty strong conditions in terms of the neighborhood structures of subsets of nodes of a certain size. If we turn to random graphs, in particular Erdős-Renyi graphs or random regular graphs, we can state conditions in terms of the average degree. So in that case, if the average degree Cn grows large with n, that is sufficient for fluid level optimality. If the average degree grows like square root of n log n or faster than that, that is sufficient for diffusion level optimality. And these conditions are quite striking in the sense that they coincide with the conditions for Dn in the basic supermarket model with join the shortest queue Dn policies. So in that sense, it's to be expected that we need at least this many neighbors to have sufficiently many reroute options for the incoming tasks. But what is remarkable is that these conditions are also sufficient, because in a way we are sort of more restricted in our reroute options, because we are sort of every time sort of checking with the same set of neighbors rather than randomly resampling from the entire graph structure. So the sort of options for spreading the load across the entire network are more limited here due to the graph structure. And yet, the same kind of growth conditions are sufficient for asymptotic optimality at fluid scale or diffusion scale. Now, if we just want to look in terms of degree sequences or average degrees, there can be very bad graph topologies. So that randomness is really crucial to get these conditions. So if we assume that the minimum degree is essentially n for all except a very small number of nodes, that is sufficient for the graph to be fluid optimal if we allow an arbitrary topology. But there are graphs where the minimum degree is arbitrarily close to half of n. So very dense graphs, and yet they may not be fluid optimal. So there can be really very bad topologies where we don't really have enough options to spread the load around if we allow for arbitrary topologies. And similarly, when we have too many bounded degree nodes, these nodes will be very much restricted in spreading the load among their neighbors, and that would also prevent fluid level optimality of the join the shortest queue policy in these graph topologies. Okay. So to summarize, we can allow for far sparser topologies where the degree of connectivity among servers is much lower than it is in a fully connected graph and still retain asymptotic optimality on fluid scale or diffusion scale, provided the graph is sufficiently random. But if the graph structure can be arbitrarily bad, we may see a lack of optimality even in very, very dense graphs. Okay. So this was really like a helicopter view of the area and some of the recent results. The paper in the proceedings provides a survey of these results. There's a more extended version available as well. And then the full details of all of these results can be found in the PhD thesis of Debankar Mukherjee, who will graduate in Eindhoven in a few weeks' time from here. So thank you for staying till the better end, and thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Are there any questions?
Yeah, thank you. Is about the diffusion optimal or fluid optimal, do you still use the heavy traffic condition, this kind of condition, heavy traffic condition? In
the heavy traffic condition?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so the fluid optimality is for a given subcritical lambda mm-hmm. that does not depend on n. Mm-hmm. So any lambda, it can be arbitrarily close to 1, but it is fixed, mm-hmm. should not grow with n. The diffusion level optimality is indeed in a heavy traffic regime where the lambda, the load per server, approaches 1 and the slack is of order 1 over square root of n. So that is what is usually referred to as the health and width regime, where both the system grows large in size and the load approaches the critical value of 1 with a 1 over square root of n.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So that is kind of heavy traffic condition.
Yeah, so that is what we consider for diffusion level optimality. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And of course, one could sort of look at other scaling regimes for the load as well. And if the traffic load approaches 1 even faster than at the rate 1 over square root of n, then at some point, for example, the join the idle queue strategy might break. That just knowing the empty queues is no longer sufficient to maintain optimality if the load sort of approaches 1 even faster. So yes, it's sort of a subtle issue, exactly how fast can the lambda approach 1 as you scale the system.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you.
Other questions? So perhaps I have a question. When I am at the supermarket, my feeling is that all the lines have not the same mu. And Can we imagine some similar results when mu is random, IID random variables, so it remains exchangeable, for example?
That is a very interesting question. And there are lots of things that happen in supermarkets that are not captured in the basic model. So I'm personally not a big fan of the term supermarket model, but somehow it has become the common term for these models. Other things are that people might be jockeying between queues, change their minds. Besides the fact that the mus are probably heterogeneous, maybe even sort of, you could think of them as a random sort of sampled from a random distribution, the surface times probably are not exponential. I mean, you see some people with just a few items and then other people who do groceries for, you know, a month's period. So there are lots of issues that arise in supermarkets and for that matter also in data centers or other situations that are not captured by this model. So there are lots of things that also have to do with general service requirement distributions that can really have a strong effect there, and again, I didn't have time to discuss that. Now, coming to your specific question, I think that would be very interesting to think of the mus as generated from some distribution. If you assume, for example, that that distribution has sort of mass in a sort of a finite number of points, then you could think of it as having different classes or different types of servers. Certainly in the large n limit, you would expect to see a certain proportion of the servers with a rate mu1, certain proportion with a rate mu2. That can probably be tackled, although lots of things immediately start to change. Like with power of d, you have to become worried about stability, for example. So it opens up a lot of issues that are all very important, but that really go beyond what I could present here today. But I think it's a very interesting way to think of them as sort of randomly generated, and then also consider similar types of scaling limits.
Yes, and probably your JIQ model is still a good model for, even if mu is random, no?
That's an excellent question, and again, it's something that I didn't have time to mention in the talk. The result of Stoliar that I showed for the fluid limit of join the idle queue, that was established under much more general assumptions with heterogeneous server pools. So a little bit like what I just mentioned, this fraction P1 of the servers has rate mu1, a fraction P2 has a rate mu2. I don't think he allows for them to be randomly generated, but I would suspect that the same result goes through. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So I think we can thank Shem again.